مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله كمثل حبة أنبتت سبع سنابل
وكل في فلك يسبحون
ويخلق ما لا تعلمون.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to a new episode of our program, The Universal Quran. Inshallah, today we will complete the rest of Surah Al-Hujurat, and after that we will move to a new surah. Back to the issue of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who guides you to faith, as he said in the last verses of Surah Al-Hujurat. بَلِ اللَّهُ يَمُنُّ عَلَيْكُمْ أَنْ هَدَاكُمْ لِلْإِيمَانِ. It's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favor who guided you to faith, or who made you believers. Because the issue of guidance, you have nothing to do with it. It's not your own, for example, deed, or it's not your own work, but it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As he says, وَمَنْ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ مُضِلٍ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides somebody, nobody can misguide him. And if somebody was misguided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nobody, of course, whatever his position is, whatever powers he has got, for example, can never guide you. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says also in Surah Al-Balad, وَهَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ. So the issue of hidayah and the issue of guidance is mainly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirms this meaning by saying, بَلِ اللَّهُ يَمُنُّ عَلَيْكُمْ أَنْ هَدَاكُمْ الْإِيمَانِ. So it's only him who guided you. It's only him who paved you the way for such guidance. And then this guidance is only being given to those who are sincere. In kuntum sadiqeen. If you are trying to seek the truth, if you are trying to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be quicker than you to come to you and to be close to you. As he says in the holy hadith, وَمَا زَلَ عَبْدِ يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ. And still my worshipper is trying to come closer to me, and he will do that until I love him. He will do that by nawafil, by praying additional prayers. And if I love him, I'll be the hands by which he can grasp, and I'll be the ears by which he could hear, and I'll be the legs by which he could walk. And if he asks me for anything, I will reply to his request. And if he asks for my protection, I will protect him, and so on. So again, it is only you who is in need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Me and you and all of us, we are in need for him, but he doesn't need us at all, and he is above all our worship. But it's only for our own benefit, and it's only for our own welfare. And on the day of judgment, if you find your record full of good deeds, that's for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. If you find otherwise, as we have the holy hadith before, then you blame nobody, but you blame yourself. In kuntum sadiqeen. So always the Quran is talking about sadq. Always the Quran is talking about sincerity in worship. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Bayyinah, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاءَ. They were only ordered to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but with sincerity. And he says in Surah Al-Zumur, أَلَا لِلَّهِ الدِّينُ الْخَالِصِ. So the ikhlas or sincerity is something which is very important. Why? Because sometimes you might do something and it's just for the sake of people. The people would say, for example, okay, this person is great. He is, mashallah, he's hafiz. Mashallah, he's memorizing the Quran, and he reads the Quran from his memory. Here, this is the worst thing. If you do anything mainly for showing off or for the sake of people, then you're deed will be spoiled, and you will have nothing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have a hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ told us that there are three types of people by whom the fire or the hellfire will start. One of them is the martyr, and another one is the scholar, another one is the hafiz. Those three people are, according to our own conception, we think that they are sincere. One of them is the martyr. A martyr, a person who fought for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he died in the state of being a martyr. Yes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment will bring him. He knows very well what he has done, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him just to display the case before people and to show people that this person was not sincere in his deed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him, what have you done? He would say, oh Allah, I have fought for your own sake and for your own cause. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, no, you fought for the sake of people. People would say that you are brave, you are a good warrior, you are courageous. And people said, you have got your reward in the previous life, in the dunya, and today you have nothing with us. So he will be taken to hellfire. Another one is the scholar. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say to him, what have you done in your dunya? He would say, oh Allah, I have learned, I have sought knowledge for your own sake, and so on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say to him, no, you are not saying the truth. You sought knowledge because people would say that he's a scholar. He is a knowledgeable person. He knows everything. MashaAllah, he is great. And he is among the leading scholars, a mufti, a sheikh, alim, and so on. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to him, you did that for the sake of people. And then people said that you got your reward in the dunya. You have nothing with us today. He will be taken to hellfire as well. And another one is the munfiq, or the generous, or the one who spent his money for the poor, and paying zakah, and paying sadaqah, and making charity, and all these things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to him, what have you done with your money? He would say, oh Allah, I didn't leave any place in which I can spend money, but I spent money. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, no, you didn't do that for my own sake, but you spend money. So people would say, you are generous, you are a very good person, you pay for charity, you pay for zakah, you help the poor, you pay for the hospitals, and so on. People said that in the previous life, and today you have no reward with us. So, subhanAllah, a few days ago I was sitting with one of the people, and I asked him, brother, akhi, you look a little bit tired, are you okay? And he said, oh, I'm so sorry, but I spent loads of days performing fasting. I fasted for nearly 2 continuous months. And I said, subhanAllah, this person is spoiling his deed by talking about what he has done. So, subhanAllah, as the Prophet ﷺ, he said, among the 7 people who will be protected under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will be under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment. One of them, he spent his money to the extent that his left hand doesn't know what his right hand has paid. Okay, so if you want to do something, nobody should know about it. Even your relatives, your wife, do it secretly, do it sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the man that I told you about, you could say he was proud of fasting. Or some people, when they pray, you say to him, akhi, and he would say, oh, alhamdulillah, I prayed as the great sheikhs, as the imam of al-haram, for example, or as the scholars. But no, you shouldn't say that. When you do anything, you make it sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't like that. If you do anything and then you are waiting for the reward of people, make sure that you will have no reward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the last verse of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, Inna Allah. So inna here means emphasis, means confirmation. Inna Allah ya'lamu ghayb as-samawati wal-ard, wallahu basirun bima ta'malun. So here the Quran focuses on the issue of ghayb, on the issue of unseen. Nobody knows about the ghayb except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody can claim that he knows what will happen, for example, tomorrow, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If somebody says that, then he is a kafir, because it's the issue or knowing what will happen tomorrow is rested with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As he said in the last verse of Surah Luqman, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثَ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. So nobody can claim that he has got any knowledge about these 5 things. For example, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ. Nobody can say that he knows about the Day of Resurrection, the Day of Judgment, because this is rested with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If people, for example, or anybody believes this person, then he is not a Muslim, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that in the Quran in many verses, that the issue of the Day of Judgment, nobody knows about it or about its time, about and so on. Exactly, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As he said in Surah An-Nazi'at, for example, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةَ أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا فِيمَا أَنْتَ مِنْ ذِكْرَهَا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ مُنْتَهَاهَا. So the end, or the knowledge of this day, is mainly in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is mainly rested with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes, why should we focus on this? Because from time to time, sometimes you might read in the news, for example, or read a newspaper or a magazine, a person, for example, claims that, for example, in the year of 2015, as I was reading an article a few days ago, and they said after, for example, 10 or 12 years, the whole world will come to an end because they have made some calculations. If you remember, a few years ago, people said, okay, when the 2000 year will come, then there will be a big problem in the world. Another person said that this might be the end of the whole universe, the end of the whole world. And he is lying because nobody knows that except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can never claim that you know, for example, what would happen not tomorrow, but even after 5 minutes from now. Because the issue of that, or the knowledge of what will happen tomorrow or after an hour from now, for example, is mainly in with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you shouldn't believe in these things. As a believer, as a good believer, you shouldn't believe in the knowledge of people who claim that, for example, they tell you about star science, about your future, about like the fortune teller, because we have a great warning from the Prophet ﷺ. Sorry, sometimes we might go away from the verse, but just these things are very important, and as Muslims, we need to know our religion very well. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, the one who goes for a soothsayer or a fortune teller, for example, and he believes what he says or what she says, then he has disbelieved in what was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is in the case if you believe it. For example, some people bring the newspaper, and the first thing they do, they read the star signs, what my star says to me today. If you believe in that thing, then you are not a Muslim, according to the authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even and other people say, sorry, we just take that for fun, for amusement, for entertainment. You shouldn't do that. Avoid this thing, because you might be in, for example, in a problem, in a religious problem, in something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't like. Okay, if somebody, for example, goes to this person just for, as we say, for entertainment, or just to spend the time, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَإِنْ ذَهَبَ إِلَيْهِ لَا يَقْبَرُ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى مِنْهُ عَمَلَ أَرْبَعِينَ يَوْمًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept your deeds, your prayer, your worship, your fasting, your hajj for 40 days because you just went to this person for fun or for anything else. You shouldn't do that, because as a Muslim or as a mu'min, you have to leave everything for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you, and He will take care of you, and He is taking care of you. And as he said in the holy hadith of Ibn Adam, لَا تَسْأَلْنِي عَنْ رِزْقِ الْغَدْ كَمَا لَمْ أَسْأَلُكَ عَنْ عَمَلِ الْغَدْ. Don't ask me about tomorrow's provision. I didn't ask you about tomorrow deeds. So the knowledge of a sa'ah, the knowledge of the Day of Judgment, even the Prophet ﷺ. So if anybody who is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the Prophet ﷺ, he said, وَلَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبَ لَاسْتَكْثَرْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ. If I have any knowledge about the future, about, for example, the Day of Judgment, then I would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for more goodness and for more favors, but he doesn't know that. And even the Prophet ﷺ, he has no knowledge about the resurrection or the Day of Judgment. So who else can have an idea, or who else can claim that he has got an idea about, for example, the end of the world, or about? No, we shouldn't believe those people. But we have to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have to believe mainly that the issue of ghaib is mainly in the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody knows what will happen tomorrow except Him. Even the Messenger himself, none of the prophets was given something about the unseen, or was given about, for example, when the Day of Judgment is going to take place. يهدي به الله من اتبع رضوانه سبل السلام.
You're live and ask other questions, please.
I would like Sheikh to comment on that and to give me how can I answer.
Listening to the adhan and repeating after the muadhin is similarly a highly recommended act of worship.
So how does she reply to her?
This is what we call it an invalid analogy. Because simply there is no comparison between answering 4 out of 5 in any exam and skipping a fariḍah such as, or a pillar such as, the prayer. no one is exempt from praying except women during the menses.
Sister Saud also wants to know if a woman has to cover her feet when she's praying.
The four fuqaha, Abu Hanifa, wa Malik, wa Shafi'i, wa Ahmad, the greatest representatives of the fiqh schools, are in agreement. It is haram.
Allah ya'lamu ghayba as-samawati wal-ard wallahu basirun bima ta'malun. And he said in Surah Al-Jinn, again the verse we mentioned just a few seconds ago, alimul ghaybi fala yuthiru ala ghaybihi ahadan illa man irtada min rasulin fa innahu yasduku min bayni yadayhi wa min khalfihi rasada. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this chapter of Al-Hujurat, he says that the knowledge of the unseen is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So nobody, whatever his position is, whatever he's a scholar, and so on, he has no idea about that. And if anybody would say anything about that, we have to say to him that you are a big liar. And we can never believe in what you say, because we have our own constitution. We have to refer our issues to the Quran. Whenever we have any problem, we need to go back to the Quran. As I said before, one of the scholars or maybe the imams, he said, if you need anything for this life, read the Quran. If you need anything for the next life, read the Quran. If you want both of them, read the Quran. So the Quran has a solution for all our problems and has told us about anything. The Quran, if you have any problem, any dilemma, you need a consultation, go back to the Quran, and of course you will be safe and you will find tranquility, you will find safety, you will find that some kind of relief you can find in the Quran. Just read it, and subhanAllah, if you are a little bit angry, try to make wudu and read the Quran, and your anger will go immediately. So we need to refer the issues to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Imam al-Hasan al-Basri, when he was asked about how you reach this position of asceticism and being a great scholar and being so and so, he said that because of a few things. One of these things that I am quite sure that my sustenance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so I have no worry about that. And I'm quite sure that nobody knows about the unseen except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so I am pretty sure that the issue of the unseen is rested with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also is saying, Wallahu basirun bima ta'amaloon. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows very well what you do, and He knows very well whether you are doing that for His own sake or for the sake of people. You are doing it with sincerity, or you are doing that as some people, for example, sometimes, subhanAllah, they boast or they feel proud. If they give some people money, they print something in the newspaper and said, for example, this person donated $1,000, $2,000 for so and so, and he mentioned his name. SubhanAllah, you shouldn't do that, because you need to do things sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get the full reward. Because, okay, you might get the praise of the people, but this is just for temporary, and then you will have nothing in the hereafter. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا عِنْدَكُمْ يَنْفَدُ وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَاقٍ. Whatever you have will come to an end, will vanish, will finish, will disappear, will dwindle. But what in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase and will never to come to an end. As we have a report in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to Prophet Moses alayhi salam. He said to him, O Moses, don't feel scared, because in the issue of provision, as long as my cases are full, my treasures are full, and they will never be empty. Even if all people, as he said also in another holy hadith, يا عبادي لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم قاموا في صعيد واحد فسألوني فأعطيت كل واحد مسألته ما نقص ذلك من ملكي إلا كما ينقص المخيط إذا أدخل البحر. Oh my worshippers, if all of you, the human beings, the jinns, were to stand in one place and everybody asked me about something. This person, for example, he needs apartment, and this body needs, for example, a car, and the other one needs a position. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled their request, and He gave everybody, if somebody, for example, needs a building, and he was given that, and then at the end Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this, as I said, this will never decrease the kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just exactly as if you have a needle and you put it, for example, in the Pacific Ocean or in the Mediterranean, so this will not decrease the kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So make sure that all the requests of people, if they were to be fulfilled, then this will never also decrease his kingdom and will never decrease his treasure. So you have to be pretty sure about Allah's provision. You need to be pretty sure about Allah's protection, and he will never let you down as long as you are sticking to his religion and as long as you are trying to do your best to come closer to him, as he said in the Holy Hadith that he will be with you and he will help you and he will never let you down. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, إن الله يعلم غيب السماوات والأرض والله بصير بما تعملون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything about you and knows whether you are sincere in your dua. Another thing also, when you make dua, you need to make it sincerity. Make sure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond to your call. If not today, then it will be tomorrow. If not tomorrow, then it will be in the hereafter. And we have a report that when people on the Day of Judgment or in the hereafter, when they would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why didn't you respond to our calls in the previous life, he would say to them, okay, look what I have prepared for you here. This is just, I postponed the response to your call for something which is greater. And then they would wish that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't respond to any of their calls in the previous life because of the great reward that will be waiting for them in the hereafter. So here we are in need, in this month especially, we need to exert a fabulous effort, because Ramadan is a kind of, as scholars say, it's about big market, and in which some people would gain a lot of gains and other people would lose a lot. So try to consider yourself among the winners and never think about being a loser, because try to use every minute, try to use every second. You shouldn't leave any chance in which you can come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you should do it. And you shouldn't leave any place in which you can remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can pray, you can offer a kind of worship, but you should do it, and you should come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by all means. And because a great reward will be prepared for you, as he says, فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ جَزَاءً بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Nobody knows about the reward of the hereafter, because nobody, of course, has been there. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised us that a great reward is being prepared for those who feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a great reward, like an example in Surah Al-Rahman, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِمَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ جَنَّتَانَ. The one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have two rewards and will have two different kinds of paradise in the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nazi'at, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. So the one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then he didn't follow his desires, then his reward will be what? Will be Jannah, will be paradise, will be the place in which you can find things that you have never imagined before. This is the place we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make all of us go to it, to admit all Muslims to paradise and enjoy the pleasures and blessings of paradise. And the best, the highest pleasure that you will enjoy there is to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we are told by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins and to accept our fasting, to accept our qiyam, and to accept the whole month from all Muslims. And at the end, I leave you in the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until we meet again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa tara al-jibala tahsabuha jamidatan wa hiya tamurru marra as-sahab. Sun'a Allah alladhi atqana kulla shay'in. Innahu khabirun bima taf'alun.
مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله كمثل حبة أنبتت سبع سنابل
وكل في فلك يسبحون
ويخرج